What's OSM? For those who do not know a word about OSM, you are in the right room, in the right event, because you'll know everything that we have. There's nothing left in OSM that won't be covered today, hopefully, besides the technical hands-on that have a separate type of events, as you know, with different type of facilities. But besides that, for an overview, this is the right event to come. Okay, so what is the promise of NFV? I mean, here what you are trying is to change this picture that I'm showing here, that coming from initial phase of installation of physical elements, to put all the wiring, some day one configuration, so they get the initial personality, those nodes, and are configured in the manner that you want. And more important, what happens right after, when the actual customers come in, and you need to operate it. The day two is actually a way to abbreviate what happens when I launch a service, which is day two, three, four, hundreds of days, right? And the thing is that this is a bit awkward in the way that this is processed today because it's conditioned by the way that the physical elements are handled. So NFV comes to the rescue. The virtual world is way more convenient for us precisely for that reason, because it helps us to, first of all, it blurs the bridge between the day zero and the day one. What you need is to get the network service ready, period. And that is what the NFV is facilitating. There is a lot of effort spending this industry on that initial phase, because without that initial phase, you will never get to the most interesting part, which is the day two. But still, it's worth paying attention to the day two as well, because the day two is where the service will live as long as it's interesting for anyone, right? So that is what is the promise of NFV. But and that promise, and I've summarized this a couple of times, is as simple as having a set of replaceable components that you can assemble in a manner that you build a network service. That's what we call as an NFV catalog, a VNF catalog, sorry, and this is how we build a network service. And we do that extending the amount of pieces that we can use. So we can acquire new pieces in a process that is called onboarding, and eventually we can assemble them with a blueprint, which is the network service definition. So far, so good. So we are done, apparently, right? not really. Before going forward, I'd like to share with you some reflection about this. I mean, sometimes we miss key parts of the picture. So I'll start with you a game, right? So, and hopefully you can play with me. So, if say that we want to acquire a spaceship, right? And we need to choose among those two. So, the one on the left was designed in the 60s, and the one on the right was designed in the 60s, so we are even here. But the one on the left can travel faster than 8 times like speed, which is fairly cool, right? The one on the left is much slower, apparently, because it can only travel to a very tiny amount of light speed, 37 millionths of light speed. The one on the left is capable, is much larger than a football pitch. Much larger than that, actually. And it's comfortable for tens of people living there, right? Well, the one on the right is, if you are lucky, you can consider it's a bit bigger than an open kitchen, and it's terribly uncomfortable for just 3 people. Okay. The one on the left kept the interest of the public for decades, and it keeps doing so, while the other just kept the interest of the people around 8-10 days at most. And sometimes someone reminds about that. In the first one, you can wear very comfortable clothes, very cool ones, you'll see it in a minute, while the other it requires, in order to keep you alive, to wear really awkward outfits. The question is that the one on the left never flew for real, while the one on the right can bring you to the moon and return safely. So only that small piece of information each is call me strange, I would choose the one on the right if I want to go to the moon. It's a matter of test, right? So the reality is ugly, but it's cool because it works. So if you like wearing pajamas and be on TV, still the one on the left is super cool. I would totally recommend it. But if you want to go to the moon for real, then you should go through all that pain that I described before. Okay? Small reflection. So, what's out there then? So, the reality is more complicated, as I said, it's more complicated. And operating a real virtualized network is not like managing a set of Lego pieces. I kept you engaged because of that, but the reality is much uglier, right? And it's a combination of a set of technologies that need to be assembled in a distributed fashion, actually. So, and even having apparently the same type of technology, the different data centers that you'll see here, different data centers, even the ones of OpenStack, for instance, can be optimized for different aspects that are contradictory. Density goes against high IO behavior, or I mean, latency goes against throughput. So you need to optimize and take some decisions and combine them, right? And that's, and you know what? Having choices is good. So it won't go away. This complexity, not talking about different type of providers, different technologies, and even the presence of public cloud that is here to stay too. So the challenge for end-to-end orchestration looks like that. Okay. Sorry, someone was taking a picture and I was too fast. Okay. Now, you'll have the slides anyway. But take pictures. So the thing is that if you zoom in into those clouds, that is usually what we do. I mean, if you zoom in, the reality is even more complex, even uglier. Because there are different types. If you see here, in an NFVI domain, you have different type of NICs that behave differently for some reasons. You have different generation of servers that behave differently. You have different type of hypervisors, and that is not a bad thing. And even you have different type of VMs. Sometimes we forget in this picture about the SDN part that requires different type of switches that are involved, and apparently we want to make them interchangeable somehow, and there are different technologies for controlling them. So we need to be inclusive in the picture, right? And in the case of the VNFs, in spite of the efforts of normalization around the way that we configure the VNFs, the reality is telling us that there's no such a thing as that uniformity. And depending on what is the background that the people have developed that VNF is using, you might have approaches like Ansible in one extreme, you might have Netconf and YAML for configuration in the other end, or you might have even Spect or whichever other spec that comes, right? So it's diversity, and we need to face it, right? And that complexity can lead to also to some side effects in the way that we operate that, because the theory says that we request the orchestrator something and it manages to make it work. But the reality says that is not that automatic, because there are many things that remain to be modeled successfully in that picture. We're talking about the console access or the pre-creation of some flavors, the way that we customize the cases, the way that there are some customizations that are required to successfully onboard a VNF, which in reality does not pay back. It's even more complicated than it was formerly with physical components. Probably this is the first time that you've seen this. Not really, right? So this day zero and day one, that is why day zero and day one are in the mind of many people in industry. Only for this, because this initial step is not completely covered. Part of the issues is that we are in a comfort zone in modeling, and I think that you'll follow me, because if you don't get all those attributes successfully incorporated, the onboarding is hard. In reality, not in Star Trek, in reality, it's hard. And then it's clear that every BNF is created differently, so you don't have an uniform catalog unless that you are making big compromises in the functionality. The blueprints are rather basic, so what you get is something like that. And you are lucky, because all this that I'm describing like this is a lot of effort and a lot of hours spent of engineering. So this is a waste. So I say, okay, now I'm really disappointed about this situation, but what are you doing about it? Okay, here we, this is where we explain how we want to take you to the moon. So there's a maturation. This is a journey. And there are new technologies that will arrive that need to be considered. It's a dynamic process, and I think that is the key thing, is that in every new cycle of development, you find out that there are new technologies out there that are relevant, commercially speaking. So first thing is that you need to focus on something that is achievable, something of what is in common on all these pictures. So you are not distracted by everything else, which is by definition everything else. And those multiple technologies are here to stay. So it's better that you embrace them and you have a future-proof approach to them, right? Of course, we want to leverage on the work of ETCNV. Okay. Reinventing the wheel does not make any sense here, and there's a huge amount of valuable work there. So it's better that we don't reinvent the wheel. In that check of the reality today, by definition, is brownfield. The reality of tomorrow, from our perspective, is greenfield. Let's see. But still, you need to be able to accommodate and prepare for the brownfield, because without brownfield, you won't get greenfield. Performance matters. I won't spend much time about this. So the way that we orchestrate the placement of the BNFs and allocate the resources matters a lot. We can be naive about that. And here, our perspective is that open source is a tool to facilitate convergence. So it's a tool and not a mean. Okay. Of course, this needs to go hand to hand with the Eure standards, if you allow me, but needs to have some degree of freedom to provide useful feedback. It's not a pipeline. And as a byproduct of this process, you need to build a wide and you are building a wide and competitive market, because you have, as a byproduct, you have an actual software that works, and also opens the door to incorporate innovations, things that were not considered at the beginning, but they can be incorporated and become part of the core of the system. Okay, so there are some requirements to make open source fit for purpose. Not just any open source will work in the manner that I've described. That would be wishful thinking. You need to put some rules there. One of them is it should be open to all players, and players of all sizes, not just the big ones or the small ones or one type of player. This to be literally open to incorporating all that expertise and all that feedback. Otherwise, you're creating something for a niche market. It should be sustainable and reliable. That's very important. If you have an actual upstream code of quality, others can trust on that upstream code to build their own products. So they are putting that effort in a bet that is sustainable over time. So the leaner, the better. And very important, this is not about creating the architecture from the top to the bottom. It's about interoperating with whichever else, with all the options that are around. So there's a lot of focus, there should be a lot of focus on interoperability and in testing, more than just trying to extend to everywhere, right? It should be open to new technologies, of course, as I said, and it should be ready to deliver. If we are not delivering, it's useless, the initiative. So what does OSM provide in practice? Well, a way that we can put it is providing a production quality mano stack, particularly for what comes above the beam, right? So it's available for everyone. So you can like it or dislike it, but everyone gets the same experience. It's very opinionated in the way that its descriptors work. It's suitable for all BNFs in principle, operationally significant, so we can have the transition that I mentioned at the very beginning, and it's being independent, independent of the SDN and also the BIM. Okay? So, and we are producing the feedback that I described. What OSM provides in the following that equation is a path to minimize entry barriers in the market. So if you are running, you are developing your BNF in a small laptop, what we can guarantee with OSM is that the same descriptors and the same images can be reused across all the chain, so you can test it at scale and you can even bring it to the final customer. In this case, a service provider, but it could be another type of final customer. This is the promise and the reality that OSM is delivering today. Okay. And also, something that is fairly important is that it's feasible to integrate it in brownfield environments. And that and one of the key things is that it's providing a very obvious Northbound interface to integrate with. So you don't have 10 integration points, you have one in the Northbound. And everything else is fed by an information model. And that means that you have the BNF packages where you have all the information of your BNFs, of course, and the NS packages that describe the way that you assemble them and you stitch them, right? So this is what it provides. You have the root of the resources, so anything that is related to the way that you manage the resources goes on the right, and then if you trust the behavior of the BIM, that we should, then it will create and allocate the resources for you. And then you have all the information of the management procedures that is packaged like that, so it can be successfully handled. See that at some point in this process, we are no longer distinguishing between physical and virtual. Because from the perspective of the left side of the picture, you can't really tell whether you are managing virtual or physical assets. And this is very important if you want to go to an actual zero-touch operation end-to-end. Okay? How do we do that? Using a set of SDN and BIM connectors on the right, so the platform gives you that ability, so you don't need to bother about which type of resources or infrastructure you would have there. Those details are taken into account by the OSM platform, and also the way that the BNF interacts, it needs to be configured, is bundled in the channels mechanism that provides an execution environment. Okay. And something that, as I said, is another way of reading this is that is intended to run across different type of beams in the southbound, but also different type of infrastructures, but that would be a bit redundant here, but also the different kind of OSS systems is not really demanding a huge change in the OSS either. So you can go to brownfield immediately. Okay, here the key is about providing what is missing, the piece that is missing, and also making sure that you are interoperable. And that is a big focus that you need to have in this picture. It's not about doing everything yourself, it's about recognizing what are the targets for interoperability. This is the scope of OSM, which, making a long story short, is providing you everything that you would need in order to achieve that objective. And of course, the decomposition of the components, et cetera, is like the one that I described, but that's not cast in stone. What is cast in stone is the objective, not the way that the elements are assembled and organized. That said, of course, OSM has, of course, the elements that are required from the SCNV architecture, provides that functionality, plus some ability to manage the network services end-to-end from the perspective of their own life cycle in terms of the way that the service needs to be operated, not just about the resources. And of course, provides other type of tools that are complementary and help, yeah, like a GUI to design the network services, the VNFs, and so on. It's not anywhere, but it's common sense to include it. Okay. In this case, OSM community, how is doing OSM in terms of getting that a large base of companies engaged? I would say rather well. I mean, there are 95 companies today as part of OSM with a nice composition in terms of service providers and final users. Actually, this slide, I'm sorry, I didn't have the chance to update it with the latest logo, which is the University of Bristol, but that is the pace at which we are seeing the incorporation of new players. I think it's worth, and this is a process that is alive. This is just a sample of what's happened between two release cycles, so the new incorporations to OSM community. I mean, you can see some well-known logos that Amazon and Katie that provide completely different perspectives, as you may imagine, in terms of their needs and expectations regarding an OSM system, and it's super useful to have both on board, and different participants from the academia, from the commercial side of different VNFs, from the monitoring, super important. You'll see a demo about monitoring and telemetry later. I mean, we are getting literally all the type of expertise that we need. But that said, it's open to fellow travelers, so why don't we can make in the next workshop 100? So, I mean, it's open to fellow travelers, and I'm seriously saying that whoever who has a serious initiative about an NFV space, or someone who is considering to have one, is kindly welcome to join, because they will see how useful for their purposes is being in OSM. Okay, but we were talking about going to the moon. It's still unclear. Okay, the objective is clear, but now how will you take me to the moon? Are you delivering? So as Luis Jorge said, we are about to launch our next release, the release 4, but we have a track record of delivering. Actually, it's a bit confusing because we started by release 0. I mean, we needed to have do something geek there. So we started by 0. So we are about to launch our 5th release, which is the release 4, okay? And we've been participating in the in key events in the industry, as you've seen. The point is that the amount of traction that we are getting is not exclusively the one that the OSM community gives, but also the large community of users of OSM who are actively testing it and giving us feedback. And for us, it's super valuable because it keeps us in the mood of learning something. So over 2,000 installs and upgrades, over 8,000 and rising downloads, and from literally any country. So we are really proud about this mechanism, because over each release, over and over, we see this pattern happening. So OSM is relevant for all of them. And this is also that is consistently reflected in industry statistics, in spite of the mood, depending on the region, by the way, and I know that probably in the region could be a different perception. OSM is really important for commercial strategies, right? I'm glad that we could bring finally this report here. So about what is the expectation about OSM, which is in the top. By the way, something that is interesting is where are the proprietary approaches in this picture in terms of long-term plans. Okay. Interesting. But what I think is more interesting is that this survey is biased. But it's biased geographically because more than one half of the questions were, all the answers were collected from here, from the US. So that is coherent with what we are seeing on a daily basis. But it's good that we can summarize that in some information that is publicly available and coming from an independent source. So I wanted to share this with you today. This is fairly new. In terms of functionality, and you'll be wondering how come that so many people are trying this and using this actively? Because it works and provides a lot of functionality already. And that is where, and of course there will be things to add. But there are many things that make it super useful for many initiatives already all over the world. So release 2 and 3 already brought a large set of functionalities that I don't want to forget just because we are launching another release. I mean, what I've said about the support of multiple bins and SDNs is real. And it's working for a long time now. Even the ability to combine them cleverly. So that is possible today. The installation process is super smooth. And that is one of the keys why there are so many people using it. Because the entry barrier is fairly small. The ability to scale the network services, the dynamicity, the ability to support fully the day zero and day one, the first two stages that I mentioned before, the ability to manage a distributed a network that is geographically distributed, and many other improvements. Also, we had improved that with the ability to manage in a large organization. The way that we were managing, monitoring that back then in release 3 was experimental. The ability to interconnect the BNFs in a fairly stable fashion, the interoperability with Bio, that has been tested by the own VMware team. So we are super confident that this is future-proof also for them. The way that you can manage the BNFs and create redundancy, even add an emulator for those who cannot afford having an infrastructure on their own. We know that we are not providing the BIM, but still we can help you to emulate it in case you want test OSM. But we have not finished. So this is a preview. This is the first time that we show it in a public venue. This is a preview of what will come in with release 4. And I mean, I had to be a bit selective on what fitted in this slide because as Luis Jorge has mentioned at the introduction, this is the most ambitious release that we have ever launched. In just 6 months, we are bringing the largest set of capabilities in just one release that we have made in our short history. And that's been really challenging in terms of trying to fit all that new wave of contributions that came almost at once. But I've tried to summarize here the highlights, and probably I'm leaving something relevant out of the picture. Anyway, I mean, something that is very important for us, as I said, is our commitment to align with the specs, and we keep doing that now with a brand new northbound interface of OSM that is aligned with the CNFV spec of SOL5. We know that this is still, I mean, a work in progress somehow, but it's quite mature, so we can take it as a reference even informally. In order to minimize the degree of ambiguity, for whoever who is implementing a system in the northbound, I'm thinking of OSS systems or systems of that kind, so there's zero ambiguity, we are also providing the open API model. So you can even auto-generate the client code if you want, or at least study what is going on, so you don't have any room for interpretation here. There's been OSM 4 comes with a lot of improvements from the perspective of monitoring. You'll see that during the session because we are super proud of the progression of the monitoring and telemetry during this release. A lot of improvements as well in the way that we can model and include in the working, the way that the IP addresses are managed, and now we can check for coherency, which was one of the reasons why we were actively removing them in the past releases, because you don't want to deliver something that led the user to do something that was wrong. Now we have the ability to check for consistency. The way that the MAC addresses are set with BNFs that are not cloud ready, but still we want to keep using the legacy. And the support of different type of images. I mean, I won't spend much time on that. What I think is super important here is that also there's been a huge leap forward in the way that the experience of the end user is being improved. I mean, we have a really reduced footprint. We've improved the stability a lot. We have a better visualization of the events and the logs. That is super important for a real operation. Even a new type of GUI, but well, you will notice if you install it. A new, actually, there's a new installation process entirely based on Docker, and it's cloud native for real. And it's not just throwing some Docker containers. That's something that we did in the past, but now we can do it in the manner that is supposed to be the best practice. And it comes with batteries included, so you can have the full experience if you want with minimal effort from your side. It will be available very soon. Actually, in the next month, we hope to have it. And actually, it will be a matter of a couple of weeks if everything goes as expected. Okay. Testing that, as you may imagine, is not trivial. And thanks to the excellent support that we are getting from Etsy and all their experience on running interoperability events, we are leveraging on that infrastructure as well in order to interconnect labs provided by OSM participants in order to test against their technologies that OSM behaves consistently. That's been super useful for us because it's not that we claim that we interoperate, it's that we can test it on a daily basis if you want. And something that I had to include because it's always nice when you receive a prize, an award. I mean, we received an award in the last event in the Hague of LA123. It's been an honor and also it's a recognition for the effort that the community has made in order to get all these things rolling. Okay. So we are done, right? Are we? Nothing left? No. I mean, that would be the worst thing that we could do. I mean, as I said, we have something that is future-proof, but not only to make it future-proof, you need to stay in motion. And that motion requires that the fuel comes from the end user. And the usability is not that the one from that the developer judges that is the appropriate one, is the one that the community is judging that is the appropriate one. And of course, I mentioned that huge amount of feedback that we are receiving. That is essential in order to keep the project on track. Okay, so a lot of activity that you are seeing in the mailing list now in our Slack channel is related to the way that we can allow the end user to install it and have a successful experience. And if anything goes wrong, they can tell us. Another front here is code optimization. As I said, if you want to make real business with a code, that an upstream code, you'd better make sure that the upstream code is top quality. It's top quality. So there's been a continuous commitment from OSM community to improve the code over the releases. I'm not sure if we'll achieve the target for release 4, to be honest, but I don't really care because the optimization is there. And I think the perspective helps here if you want to compare to anything else, okay? So we can be perfectly comfortable if it's twice as much of that footprint. We could even see in the last event that there were two commercial OSM-based distributions, which is what we were looking in the last plug test, and that's a trend that we expect that will keep growing. And also that we are enabling the community of users to use OSM successfully. We have hosted in this year two hackfests of OSM, and we are planning for a third one with more demand than actually the space that we are having. So I mean we need to think of that probably to organize them more frequently or something. And actually we are planning for the third one that is coming in 3 months. This time is hosted by Telenor in Norway. And is co-located with a plenary meeting of OSM to facilitate the travel arrangements. So there are a new set of lines that we want to continue improving. We are not done, as I said. We want to consolidate that new wave of development so they can settle in the next releases. We want to give a focus to the use cases of 5G, which is fairly important for us, and improve the visibility in general of technical side and on the activities of many kinds. But we want to preserve all that you've seen today. Okay, so this will be in addition to what you've seen. Okay, you want to learn more? A quick reference. Release 4 is coming soon. There's still a relevant white paper from the release 3 that applies, of course, to anything that you will see in release 4 plus an addition. And the tutorials and examples, if you want to have some hands-on and learn how to use the system, you can do it with the tutorials and examples from the previous Hackfest. Okay? And that's all. On this side, so let me introduce Vanessa Little from VMware, who is a DSC representative, and he'll tell you about the technical details.